Coming to the next part, the first thing we are going to see is sick role. What is a sick role? A sick role is a role which a person assumes when he falls ill. So we saw that illness is the perception, and what the person then does is sick role. A sick person has to behave in a certain way. So he has got a certain prescribed way of behavior, and that behavior is then called as sick role. He becomes passive for most of the part. You know, when you go to the hospital, you take out your clothes and you take out your social status also. So you are so called puppet in the doctor's hand. The doctor orders you to do certain things and you follow those things. So assume a sick role. You may sometimes, some people also become childlike. So that what they are doing exactly is assumption of a sick role. The sick person is exempted from his normal social responsibilities. So if he was working, now he's not expected to work. If he has to go and do some course, now because he is sick, he is exempted from because of the sick role. So when a child, he does not want to go to school, he may assume a sick role. Okay, the stomach is paining, the most common complaint. I would not go to the school today because I have a stomach pain. The second thing is that the sick person needs to be cared for. So there is an underlying assumption that if somebody is sick, you need to take care of the sick person, and like I said, he is exempted from his daily duties. Sick role is regarded as a misfortune. So nobody will come to your house and say it's good that you have fallen ill. You'll always have cards or flowers, and people will say, when are you going to recover? How bad is it that you fell ill? So sick role is in general considered as a misfortune. The sick person, although he is sick, is at least obliged to seek competent medical care in order to get fit as soon as possible. So this is also the duty of the sick person. If a sick person wants to enjoy the benefits of sickness, it is also his duty to seek competent medical care so as to get back to normalcy as soon as possible. Most of the times, people are genuinely sick or they have certain diseases which render them incapable for the duties. Sometimes people may fake sickness. The most common reason is to escape their duties or for financial gains. These kinds of sickness then are called as factitious disorder. When a person assumes a sick role for a financial benefit or for not fulfilling his duties, then that is called as a factitious disorder. The next topic that we are going to see is the art of interviewing. Aims of interviewing are to secure information, to get the portrait of the entire personality, to form a hypothesis, to collect personal data for quantitative purposes, and to collect secondary data. So these are the aims for interviewing. What are the kinds of interview? The first one is a direct or a structured interview. A structural interview is the one where you have a questionnaire, you go to the subject, you read out the questionnaire, he gives you answers and you write them down. So they are mostly closed-ended questions. When you ask questions, there are two types of questions. One is an open-ended question, wherein you ask a question like, how are you feeling today? And he would like to describe how he is feeling today. The closed-ended question would be, are you a male or a female? So there is only one specific response and the answer terminates. So the to the point question, what do you say, is a closed ended question. Open ended question is, what brought you here today? So you expect the person to reply in a more long way and to express what he feels more fully. So in a direct interview, we use usually closed ended questions. There is a questionnaire format and that format has to be followed. Non-directive or unstructured interview. This is when you go to your friend's house and you talk. So that kind of discussion. You have a topic, you start talking about it, there is no particular structure, there are no particular questions. You want to gather all information that is available on a particular topic. So this is unstructured interview, wherein people are asked open-ended questions and they give open-ended answers. Focused interviews. Focused interviews are usually done for assessment of your beliefs and attitudes towards a particular health service. Say for example, I want to know how is the family welfare program being taken up by a village or a community? I would like to have a focused interview. A subtype of this is also the focus group interview, where you have a moderator, a person for recording what was said in the interview, and you have people who are talking about the issue. The function of the moderator is not to dictate to the participants. The function of the moderator is just that of a facilitator. If the discussion is sidelined, if the discussion is not on the topic, it has deviated, then the job of the moderator is just to bring back the discussion to the track and continue further. So if you want to have an analysis of a particular problem or a perception about a thing in the community, this would be the interview method of choice. Repetitive interview is nothing but an interview which is followed up over a time interval so as to see the change that is happening. So to observe the change that is happening, repetitive interviews are taken, and that is called as a repetitive interview. Techniques of interviewing. The first and foremost thing that you have to do is establish contact. This is common sense, but most of the times people forgo this. Say for example, you are an intern and you have to have a health survey for a community. There was a research paper to be done in the Department of Community Medicine. You took up the project and you have the white apron, you go to the community, you directly barge into the house with your shoes on and you start interviewing. What is your name? What is your father's name? How much do you earn? Do you use contraceptives? What kind of contraceptives do you use? How many children do you have? So that kind of interviewing, that should be avoided. Although you have the authority, but that authority should be respected. So the first step should never be foregone. Establishing a contact. When you go to somebody's house, when you want to interview somebody, when you want to talk, first introduce yourself, then seek permission. If granted, you may start. So this is a very important thing. Unless and until the person knows you, why should he help you? Why should he answer your questions? So establishing contact is a very important step. Second is starting the interview. Starting the interview, you tell him about the objectives of the interview. You tell him what is exactly you want to know from him. You give him the background of the study. Say for example, you are doing a study for anemia. So you tell them that we have a lot of problem of anemia in the community, and anemia is a killer disease. It has got a lot of side effects. You can talk about some of the side effects and some of the complications of anemia, and then you set a background for the interview. That is starting an interview. Securing rapport. Obviously, a good rapport has to be secured. Otherwise, you ask the questions and he will give you a nominal answer. One of the drawbacks of observational studies, you have to believe what was answered, and therefore establishing of a good rapport is very, very important. If not, he might just give either a nonsensical answer or an answer which is not true, which would hamper your study. So securing rapport. Recall. Help him in recalling what was asked and come back to the topic if the topic deviates. Probing questions. Probing questions is, like I said, if the subject is deviated, you can have a probing question either to bring the discussion on the topic, or you want to know something in greater detail. So you have a probing question, which is a direct question on the topic so as to elicit a specific response. Encouragement. If the person is doing well, at least what you can do is you can nod your head so that you show him that you are interested. So you nod your head. Other body language, don't cross your feet, don't cross your hands, look at the sky or the roof. These are signs that you are not interested in the interview itself. If the person reads these signs, he is very less likely to talk to you. So encouragement and guiding. Recording is what you are there for. You want to record what is said, you want to have an idea of the problem, and closing the interview. When you close the interview, again, as I had discussed the importance of establishment of contact, by closing the interview, thank the person for his time. Thank the person for his patience. Even if he has not given you an interview, thank him. And this is one of the most important reasons of non-compliance by the general public to interns, or that for that matter, any measure. because we are thankless. Once the job is done, you rush out and bye bye. Okay, so that is not what should be done. What should be done is that there should be a proper closure of the interview. Thank the person you interviewed and leave. Lastly, you have to make a report and submit that. So these are the steps of interviewing. Coming to anthropology. This is again one of those words we have heard a lot, but we don't exactly know what anthropology is. So anthropology is the study of physical, social and cultural history of man. So study of physical, social and cultural history of man is anthropology. Anthropology may be divided as physical anthropology, social anthropology, cultural anthropology and medical anthropology. Physical anthropology is how have been people looking over centuries. Okay, what is the evolution? Why am I not having a tail? Why am I having an appendix? Why am I bipedal? Why am I having an oppositional thumb? So a study of these physical manifestations is physical anthropology. Social anthropology deals with the development and types of social life that people have all over the world. So people have various rituals, various customs. There's a wonderful serial which comes on National Geographic Taboo. If you have ever seen it, you know what I'm talking about. Social anthropology. What is commonplace to one culture is completely alien to another and disgusting to the third one. So we study how these customs and cultures evolved and why are they accepted in some cultures and prohibited in others. Cultural anthropology is a guesswork into the life of the contemporary primitive man. Again, a lot of shows on Discovery and National Geographic, they imagine how those prehistoric men lived, what was their culture, the cave paintings and how they evolved. So that is cultural anthropology. Medical anthropology is the use of all these sciences that we have collected into the medical field. So culture in health and disease, that study is medical anthropology. Coming to some important tits and bits which are not really meriting a lot of description, but in a smaller aspect they can be tested. So here is a compilation of all the definitions, all the small tits and bits of the chapter which are high yield. Here we go. Customs. Customs act which are accepted in a society. So customs are acts which are okay with the society. Society says if you do this, that is okay. That is a custom. Traditions. When customs are passed from generations to generations, they become traditions. So if you do something, that is a custom. Say for example, you started calling your relatives for lunch on a particular festival. That festival is not a very big festival, but you decided, okay, I want my relatives to come to my place on this particular day, and that is a custom which is started by you. Your child liked that, he took that up. 10 generations down the line, your 10th grandchild is also calling his friends and relatives on the same very day. You started a custom, he has a tradition. So customs which are passed for generations and generations are then called as traditions. Taboo, most of you understand, is taboo is a socially prohibited behavior. If a taboo is broken, the society may have strong objections. What is a taboo? Again, depends upon society to society. Ritual. Ritual is a prescribed order of ceremony. You do a puja or you do some other ceremonies and there's a prescription that this should be done after this, then this should be done, this should not be done. You bought a new house, you did some housewarming there, you should sleep in the new house on that day. So this is the ritual, prescribed order of ceremony. Socialization. As I told you then, we will be seeing socialization. Process of acquiring culture and becoming a member of the social group. So this is how you become accepted into the social group. Fortunately, I believe that you are not an African citizen and you don't have to pass through those coming of age ceremonies. Good for you. Socialization for us is then easy. Beware, the next word seems very close to socialization, but it is not socialization. It is socialism. Socialism is social ownership for raising the working class living standards. I don't want to enter into controversy, so I won't be picking up any names, but socialism is when the working class is the strongest. So the working class decides who has what and how much. The property is held in general. So you have public sector, which is very strong. The public sector is money churner, they earn, and the expenditure is spent on the greater good. That culture on a national level is socialism, as opposed to the exactly opposite dimension of socialism is capitalism. Okay, so capitalism is profit driven. Individuals are at the helm of the affairs and it is privately owned. Profit driven, privately owned is capitalism. Notable examples of capitalistic countries are United States. Social mobility. Movement across social stratifications is social mobility. Social mobility is not moving from one place to another. You move from Jabalpur to Jaipur, that is not social mobility. Social mobility is when you move through social hierarchies. There are two kinds of movements, horizontal social mobility and vertical social mobility. You changed your job, you were intern at a hospital before, you took transfer and you are intern at a hospital in a second place. This is a horizontal social mobility. You were an intern before, you joined as a resident now in the same hospital. So you have upgraded yourself. This is a vertical social mobility. Understood? Social upliftment. Giving betterment to the disadvantaged population is called as social upliftment. Social equity is equal access to basic primary needs, which can be called as human rights. So equal access of all those essential structures is social equity. We had seen that social equity is very, very important as far as health is concerned. Social insurance. Social insurance is the insurance which the society itself affords to its individuals so as they can get help in the times of crisis. Old age pension, concession to old people for railways, for buses, employee state insurance scheme. These are examples of social insurance. Attitudes. Attitude is a like or dislike towards a particular person or a situation. That is attitude. It can be positive attitude, negative attitude, neutral attitude and ambivalent attitude. Positive, negative, neutral, you understand what is ambivalent. Ambivalent is I love her but she does not pay attention to me, so I hate her. Ambivalent. I love her and I hate her. Okay, so that kind of song. Okay, ambivalent is when you are confused, you have both opposing emotions towards a person. That is called as an ambivalent attitude. By the way, when she accepts your rose, the attitude suddenly becomes positive. Coming on, attitude is not affected by motivation. We will see what is affected. Components of attitude. You have cognitive component, knowing. You have affective component, emotion. And you have an action component. So, attitudes have an effect of cognition, affection or emotion and action. Opinion. Opinion are, as you know, views on a particular topic. So, what is your opinion on this topic? That is what exactly opinion is. Opinion is your views on a particular topic. By definition, opinions are temporary and provisional. If two countries are fighting, everybody's opinion depends upon which country they belong. Okay, so those kinds of things. Beliefs are permanent and stable. So beliefs are like attitudes. Okay, they are very much stable. Emotional valence. Emotional valence is the inherent quality of something to have an emotional response from your side. It may be positive or negative. A notable example which comes to my head right now is the positive emotional valence of babies. Human brain has been programmed to feel a baby as a cute creature. If we did not feel so, we would not care for the babies. We would not be very much behind from the cats who even cannibalize their own kids. For humans, it is unthinkable. So our brains have been programmed to have a positive emotional valence towards kids. So it is an inherent property of a subject or a person to have an emotional reaction. Habit, also called as practice, is a way of doing things. Habits are good habits and bad habits. Health wise, you know what are good habits and bad habits, and they are influenced by motivation. Habits are influenced by motivation. Attitudes are not influenced by motivation. Crowd, collection of people may have an aim, may not have an aim. They are just random collection of people. Okay, so that is a crowd. Mob. Mob is usually an emotional crowd. They have something in their head, they are angry on something, and they are hell-bent on violence. So usually that collection is called as a mob. Emotionally charged, homogeneous, one single attitude, and can have propensity for violence. Poverty line, important. Poverty line is defined as the amount of money required to purchase 2400 kilocalories per day in a rural setup and 2100 kilocalories per day in an urban setup. That is poverty line. So this is the definition of poverty. These numbers, yes, you need to know this. 2400 kilocalories for rural, 2100 kilocalories per head in urban. So these are per head kilocalories, remember, per head kilocalories. This is the definition of poverty line. GNP, gross national product, is the income I generate inside my country plus what I earn outside the country. So the gross domestic product plus income from abroad. Like I said, I use the word gross domestic product is just what I produce in my country. So gross domestic product plus outside income then becomes gross national product. Purchasing power parity is another thing you should know. Purchasing power parity is, say, if I take the example of India, it would be defined as rupees that would be needed to purchase a thing which $1 can purchase in the US. Say for example, $1 purchases 10 toffees in US and I need 50 rupees for purchasing those 10 toffees, then the purchasing power parity would become 50. So it is the units of currency needed to purchase on the local market stuff which $1 would buy in the US. That is called as purchasing power parity. Thanatology is the study of death and the cultural aspects surrounding death, and thanatophobia is the fear of death. Coming to operational research, you have a big problem, the application of scientific methodology for solution of that problem is called as operational research. If you don't know operational research in detail, good, at least have a look at the steps. Formulation of the problem, collection of relevant data, analysis and formulation of the hypothesis. Of course, we want to make a hypothesis. Deriving solutions, choosing optimal solution of all the solutions that you derived, testing the solution first on a very small scale, that is called as a pilot study. If you remember, we had discussed in RCT, and if the solution works in the pilot study, then blowing up the solution and applying it for the whole big problem. These are the basic steps of operational research. It was in vogue after the World War and now also it is very much significant. So application of scientific methodology to problem solving is operational research, and these are the steps. Coming to learning, conditions affecting learning, you have of course intelligence, age of your audience, learning situation. If you are comfortable right now, learning is helped. If you are not comfortable, it is not helping my cause. Motivation, are you motivated to listen to me? I am trying my best, but if you are not motivated, it's a difficult job for me. So motivation of the subject. Physical health, I hope you are fine, you are healthy, you are competent to listen to me. And mental health. So these are conditions affecting learning. Again, learning is cognitive, affective, and psychomotor. We have seen this. Learning by conditioned reflex, learning by trial and error. So you learn by yourself. You do things, you commit mistakes, and you know what is the right recipe. So that is trial and error. Learning by observation and imitation. There are two patients, your resident is operating on a hydro seal. You look what he is doing. Okay, I'll also do that. He cut an artery, let me cut one. That is learning by imitation and learning by doing. Habits, as you already saw, begin in childhood. Frequent repetitions make habits. They can be good or bad. Breaking or making a habit takes time. They have a strong emotional stimulus, and good habits kill bad habits. With that, we finish this part. Thank you.